Yoon-ho Kim from POSTEC, who will speak about Einstein-Podolsky-Rosen entanglement of narrow-band photons from cold atoms.
Okay, thank you for the introduction. So let's talk photons. So in this talk, I would like to talk about an entangled photon source where the entanglement is a bit particular, going back to the early days of quantum physics. So this work was done by three of the students in my group. And if you are interested in reading about it, you could just go to archives. This is archive paper. I guess a good way to introduce the topic is to really show you this paper by Einstein, Podolsky, and Rosen, where they actually talk about, for the first time, entanglement in a formal paper. So in this work, what they talk about is a pair of particles that are entangled in position and momenta. So let's say you have some common particle here, and then at some point in time, it explodes. And they go in separate ways. And you can look at this one, position and momentum, and then you can also look at this one, position and momentum, independently. And you can also look at the correlation between the two particles. And when you do, assuming that the particle is initially at rest or moving at some momentum, you find that the sum of the momenta is initially, it has zero dispersion. So the sum of the momenta is fixed. However, obviously, when they get explode, individual particles' momentum, they have just all possible uncertainties. But when you give this condition here initially, and if you look at this two particle state, and they're all quantum superposed, you can write this in different forms. So let's say you are initially in momentum basis, and these two particles are momentum anticorrelated. So this momentum anticorrelation gives you basically zero dispersion in their sum of the momenta, but individually they can have a lot of dispersion. But this also gives you a position correlation. So entanglement, the nature of entanglement is that the momentum correlation naturally gives you position correlation. So the difference in the momentum, difference in the position of these two particles, there will be no dispersion, but individually they will have a lot of dispersions. So this sort of a feature, is known as a continuous variable entanglement because position and momentum, they are not really discretized. So X and P, they can take any variables, so it's known as a continuous variable. So you can think of an experiment. For instance, you have these two particles that are entangled, and then you measure something over here, right? For instance, this particle can click this detector, and this corresponds to, for instance, a measurement of position or momentum. And this click naturally gives you, due to the nature of entanglement, naturally determines where the other particle is going to be, for instance, over here. So although this was initial idea suggested by Einstein, Podolsky, and Rosen, the continuous variable in quantum optics sort of took a different turn, because it's actually quite difficult to make such a state. So in continuous variable quantum optics, we look at X and P, but they are not really position and momenta. So what they are is actually a quadrature variable. So they are actually amplitude and phase of the optical field, but not real position and momentum. So the way you prepare an entangled state in continuous variable quantum optics, you prepare a squeeze state by using OPA. So for instance, you have an amplitude squeeze light here. And then you take another one, but it's 90-degree phase difference. So now you have a phase squeeze light. And then when you overlap this to a beam splitter, what you end up here at the output of the beam splitter, you get a continuous variable quadrature entanglement between these two optical beams. But they are not really the single photon regime. They are in a sort of a appreciable detection, appreciable power. So since we talk about amplitude and phase of the optical field, when you want to measure this, you always need some sort of phase reference. And that's where the local oscillators come in. So actually, there's a very nice paper done by these people here. So in their setup, right, the scheme is actually exactly as I depicted here. So you have two OPA. Each of these OPA gives a squeeze light, and you overlap at the beam splitter. And then entangled beams are, so quadrature entangled beams are generated. And then if you want to measure this entanglement, you need local oscillators with a particular phase. And then you can actually measure the phase and amplitude correlations between these two beams. OPA, they are very good. You can actually generate narrowband entanglement in this way. But I guess as I started out, I actually want to create a real position and momentum entanglement between two photons. And as it turns out, you can actually do that much easier way by using spontaneous parametric down conversion, which is actually a very well-known tool in quantum optics. So the way you do is basically you take a piece of a Chi2 crystal, and then if you pump it hard with a laser beam, it turns out sometimes you create a pair of photons, and they tend to be entangled. And in a particular geometry where you have a laser beam itself that pumps the process is actually the dimension is big enough, then it turns out the transverse momentum between the transverse momentum of this photon and this photon, they are tightly correlated. For instance, as shown here. So because of all these photon amplitudes are superposed, it turns out this very tight transverse momentum anti-correlation actually gives you also very tight transverse position correlation. So this is actually a position and momentum correlation between these two photons. And this sort of work actually goes back to 2004 and has been actually studied quite some time. But down conversion, it's a very, very broadband light source. So when you do a down conversion, typically the bandwidth is going to be on the order of terahertz, several terahertz. And in quantum optics, you somehow want to make your photons interact with quantum memory. And typical quantum memory devices nowadays will require megahertz order bandwidth. Otherwise, it's just too broadband. It's not going to do anything. So one way you could try to achieve this is to somehow narrow the bandwidth of the down conversion. But you could actually do it if you put a crystal inside a cavity, and then if you drive it, you could actually create so-called a cavity down conversion, where the bandwidth becomes really narrow. It's good, however, this sort of a cavity cannot support the position and momentum correlation. So this can actually narrow down the bandwidth quite significantly to the megahertz regime, and also at the same time increasing the photon flux quite significantly. However, there's really no chance of producing position and momentum correlation because they just all get filtered out. So why do we want to create a position and momentum correlation between these photon pairs that are very narrow band? Well, first of all, just out of interest, we thought that we could just give it a try. But in quantum information, we can actually try to find this motivation going back to classical communication technologies. So in classical communication technologies, I mean, people are really trying to do increase the bandwidth by really doing spatial multiplexing. So in this case, all they do is really just try to use more bunch, right? Bunch of the beams. But in quantum information, all these spatial modes, they also need to be correlated. Otherwise, entanglement cannot be supported. So somehow, it's been shown so far that in quantum memory, you can store frequency-time correlations and also polarization correlations. But if you can actually do spatial mode storage, and which actually requires a continuous variable position momentum correlation, and that could actually increase the chance of so-called creating hyper-entanglement. So narrowband entanglement can actually be generated without actually using cavity down conversion. It turns out by using a cold atom cloud and by using the spontaneous Fourier mixing process, you can actually generate a very, very narrowband entangled photon pair. So here, basically, we use a double lambda scheme. And for instance, this can be iridium atom. So if you pump these two beams connecting these two lines in the opposite direction, and then a spontaneous Fourier mixing loop can be actually generated, creating a Stokes and anti-Stokes photons propagating oppositely. And it turns out these two photons are very, very narrow band, and they are energy time conserved, time entangled because of the phase matching condition. So if you can do it, it turns out you can actually create a number of interesting photon states by photon states. First of all, by using spontaneous Fourier mixing, you can generate a energy time entanglement. And these are obviously continuous variable. And you can also create a polarization entanglement that's going to be discrete variable. And in addition to that, we would like to add another degree of freedom. There's position and momentum. So if you can somehow combine all these two in two photons, probably that's as far as we can do. And of course, you can actually try to add orbital angular momentum, but that will require some sort of a position momentum entanglement in the beginning. So let's look at the energy time correlation and what this sort of a spontaneous Fourier mixing light source can actually give you. So one thing that spontaneous Fourier mixing photon pair source actually can do in the atomic regime is that it's relatively easy to engineer entanglement, frequency time entanglement. So it's a bit too much to go through in detail, but the way these photons are generated, the photon pairs are generated, they always have to satisfy the energy and momentum conservation condition. So these two photons that are being created, for instance, a signal in Stokes and anti-Stokes, they are always energy correlated. That is, if the one photon, let's say if the two photons have the same frequency, and if the one photon is slightly positively detuned, and the other photon has to be negatively detuned so that the energy sum is always constant. So this sort of frequency anti-correlation always gives you time correlation. So if you look at the biphoton detection amplitude or detection intensity, so here in this plot, so what we do here is that T1 represents a time of a click of one detector coming from, let's say, Stokes photon, and T2 represents the time of the detector click that detects the anti-Stokes photons. And it turns out, normally, what you get is this sort of a time correlation, which represents frequency anti-correlation. And most of the time, even in the down-conversion regime, you always generate some sort of a frequency anti-correlated photon pairs. And this sort of a tight correlation gives you a lot of problem when you try to multiplex, also when you try to do a multi-photon experiment, because of this sort of a time correlation always gives you distinguishing information when you try to do a 3-photon, 4-photon, 6-photon experiment. So you need to get rid of this sort of a time correlation or frequency anti-correlation. And in the fixed medium, such as a crystal, it becomes very, very difficult because unless you really have to do something to the medium to be able to change the dispersion characteristics. But when you have this sort of atomic medium, it's relatively flexible. So you can actually tune the group velocities of the photons rather easily. So by simply changing the way you pump this process, actually you can go from the time correlation to a complete time uncorrelation. Well, in this case, the frequency between these two photons are uncorrelated. And if you do even more, you can actually create a time anti-correlated state. So for instance, in this case, you see that these are the joint temporal intensity between these two photons. As you can see, they are time anti-correlated, which means that these two photons that are being generated, they are frequency correlated. So if these two photons have, let's say, start from zero detuning, if the one photon is positively detuned, and the other photon is also going to be positively detuned, and which is actually quite interesting. So this sort of entanglement engineering actually can be accomplished relatively easily in the atomic medium. And also, in the atomic medium, you can generate polarization entanglement done actually several years ago in China. So by using this right-angle geometry, they were actually able to generate a polarization entanglement directly out of atomic cloud. So the goal now is then somehow directly generating position and momentum correlation between these two, photons directly from the atomic medium. So the setup is going to be relatively simple, right? So you take you have a 2D mat here in the vacuum chamber. In our case, the optical depth is about 50, and then we use the same Fourier mixing energy levels. So you have two laser beams pumping these processes, and then a photon that is generated, a pair of photons that is generated, they are detected by this detector over here, and the other one goes to the other channel. And let's not worry about all these other things, but there are this principal question related to, first of all, how do you verify position and momentum correlation, or the position and momentum entanglement? And the second thing is that how do you really, what are the conditions for really generating tight position and momentum entanglement? And obviously, if you want to know about this, you need to know how to verify position and momentum entanglement. So let me just briefly introduce how you can actually verify position and momentum entanglement. In the squeezing experiment, you use local oscillators to be able to detect phase and amplitude quadrature. But since now we are talking about position and momentum, that is not possible anymore. So the way you would actually detect or verify entanglement between these two photons in the position and momentum degrees of freedom, it turns out there's a really well-known inequality that actually needs to be violated. It turns out we need to measure delta x minus, which is actually the dispersion or the uncertainty related to the position difference between these two photons, and delta p plus is actually the uncertainty related to the momentum sum of the two particles. And then for the separable state, these two products are always bigger than this value. So if you measure this, and then if you measure that independently, and then if it's smaller than this value, you verify that these two particles, these two photons are entangled in position and momentum. So they will require some sort of a detection, right? Position and momentum sensitive detections. So to give you an idea how to do this, and then actually how this inequality actually can be measured, so let's sort of look at a two-photon state written in the momentum basis. So let's look at this part here. So this A tilde and C tilde, they represent a wave packet and the way the wave packets are distributed in the momentum space. And we simply just use the P1 plus P2 as one basis and P1 minus P2 as the other basis. And sigma A represents the width in that basis, and then sigma C represents width in that basis. So if there's going to be some sort of entanglement, it turns out the width of this function, I mean the width of the function in the P1 plus P2 direction has to be much, much smaller than the width of this function in P1 minus P2 direction. So it's very similar to squeezing, except that we are now talking about position and momentum of these two particles. So you are going to have some sort of a symmetric state, which represents separable state. And then if you squeeze in one direction, much, much smaller than individual uncertainty relations, and then this is going to, for instance, in this case, the momentum sum is going to be now is squeezed below the single particle uncertainty regime. And as a result, obviously, there's sort of a bulging appearing in the other direction. So similarly, because of the momentum anti-correlation and due to the nature of entanglement, what's going to happen is that the position correlation naturally also occurs. So when you measure when you have a entanglement or the momentum anti-correlation between the P1 and P1 plus P2, the position difference is actually squeezed below the certain limit. So if you can somehow measure that, so let's just go back and take a step back and think about what does uncertainty relation actually mean, right? So this wave packet, and if you do a two-dimensional Fourier transform, you can write this in a position basis. And it turns out this part here and this part here, they are Fourier conjugate, and also this P1 minus P2 and C1 minus C2, they are also position Fourier conjugate. So what this tells you is that if you measure P1 plus P2, that is the momentum sum, and also the position sum, they actually cannot be smaller than the certain limit. So it has to be always greater than h bar. And the same thing goes with x1 minus x2 and also p1 minus p2. So these actually always need to satisfy these relations. But we are actually looking at p1 plus p2 and x1 minus x2, and they actually can be below the limit. So if you can measure the uncertainty in the momentum sum, And if you can measure the uncertainty in the position difference, and obviously both of them will need to be much, much smaller than single particles uncertainties. And let's say we measure sigma A, and also let's say we measure sigma C. And then using these two values, actually you can calculate whether your measurement is going to violate the uncertainty, the entanglement criteria. So another thing that's actually quite necessary to mention is that the fact that you have a correlation doesn't really mean that this correlation is really entanglement, right? So let's say you have, when you have an entanglement, position correlation means that momentum is anti-correlated. But when you have a sort of a classical correlation, momentum correlation doesn't necessarily mean that you have a correlation in the position. So you always need to measure in two different bases. So the way you would actually verify entanglement is that when you have a source, right, to measure position uncertainties, and you actually go to far field, and to measure the momentum uncertainties, you go to far field, and then if you want to measure the position uncertainty, you go to the near field. And however, this will actually require multi-pixel single photon counting detectors, and then you need to measure correlation between the two. And that becomes a bit different, quite difficult. So what we actually can do is that instead of actually using a lot of these very expensive detectors, you can actually do a simple quantum interference experiment. So you take a double slit, for instance, and stick into one of the beam. And then the other detector, so this detector doesn't actually move. And the other detector is actually placed at the focus of this lens. And then you move this detector, and then you measure the correlation. It turns out, when you do, there is a sort of interference fringe occurring in the joint detection rate, but not at the single count rate. And that actually, from that data, you can actually retrieve sigma A. And from to retrieve sigma C, what you can do is actually a similar geometry, but instead, you actually go to an imaging regime. And you can basically do the same thing, known as the ghost imaging experiment. And you can try to recover the position uncertainties, or the uncertainties related to the position difference. So the experimental conditions actually need to be derived. But roughly, the pump actually driving this process needs to be reasonably big. And then also, you need to satisfy certain parasitic conditions and so on. And in experiment, what we do is that we stick an object here, which makes the beam effectively a double slit. So double slit actually gives you this sort of a beam profile going to this detector over here. And then this detector is actually not moved. And if you go to detector over here, this is a scanning detector. Nothing more than a piece of fiber attached to a single photon detector. And it turns out, when you look at the outcome, the coincidence count between this detector and this detector as a function of this distance that's actually moved in the horizontal, in the transverse geometry, it turns out you can actually calculate the uncertainty related to the position difference and also uncertainty related to the momentum sum. So experimental data looks more likely this. So you have sort of a known as ghost interference. And from this, actually, you can actually infer delta sigma, delta x minus, and delta p plus from the data. And in a particular setup, actually, we actually show that these actually violate entanglement criteria actually quite well. So this actually shows that these two photons are entangled. But this is actually not enough. You also need to go to the position regime, and you need to be able to do the same thing. So if you go to the position regime, you need to do something called a so-called ghost imaging experiment or a quantum imaging experiment. So what you do is that you have an object here, and then the other detector here is in the image plane of this object, even though they actually are completely separate particles. And it turns out the image of this object actually can be reconstructed between the joint detection rates between those two detectors. So the data looks sort of like that. And from this data, actually, you can fit the correlation that you derive. And from this correlation equation, and also from the data, you can actually also infer delta x minus and also delta p plus, which actually does show that we actually have a pair of particles that are position and momentum correlated. So you can obviously do something more, change some parameters, and see whether the entanglement stays. And we have done that as well. So I think my time is up. So let me just summarize. So we actually have done an experiment where a pair of photons with a very, very narrow band, in our case, about 3 megahertz, and they are position and momentum entangled. And they actually show a very strong violation of a continuous variable entanglement criteria. So they are really entangled in the position and momentum. So some further work that actually we are right now thinking on is to really so-called develop a hyper-entangled narrowband photon source in, involving position momentum and polarization and energy time and so on. And this actually can also be used to test so-called quantum image storage in a quantum memory. So I think exactly zero. So let me thank for your attention, and if you have any questions, I'll be happy to answer.
So thanks a lot. Are there questions? So okay. I was wondering actually about the your work towards the coherent storage of entangled images and how you would store the position and momentum entanglement, or how you would herald that storage in a way that doesn't reveal information about the position.
Heralding is a whole totally different issue. In this case, it's all spontaneous regime. So these two photons are really spontaneously generated, right? So only when you detect both of these photons, you can actually confirm whether the entanglement is there or not. Yeah. So if you want to herald it, obviously these are pulse processes. So we have about 9 milliseconds of preparation time for the mat, and then we do an experiment for 1 millisecond after that. So the success probability, that is, that the photon pair being generated is not that high. So heralding is, at this point, it's not possible. Typically, heralding requires another photon to be detected, but here it's only two photons are being generated. So.
Okay. So if there are no questions from the audience, then let's close the session and thank both of our speakers once again.